Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 3, which will be discussion of evidence heard this morning, and all future discussions of evidence heard as part of the inquiry in private. So are members content to take this item in private and all future meetings on the committee's inquiry that involve discussions of evidence in private? Thank you. So our next item of business is the third evidence session of our inquiry into a just transition for the Grangemouth area. And today's session will focus on partnership working needed to facilitate a just transition. So I now welcome Malcolm Benny, Director of Place Services with Falkirk Council, who's joined by Adam Gillies, Community Councillor at Grangemouth Community Council, and Dermot Laylor, Associate Director of Place with the Scottish Futures Trust. Welcome to the committee this morning. And as always, if members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. And can I maybe, first of all, maybe come to Malcolm? It's a question that I'll let all three panellists address, but we're looking at a just transition for the Grangemouth area, but there is still, it seems, some debate around what a just transition means. What's the working interpretation that has been used for the Grangemouth area, and do you think people have an understanding of what is trying to be achieved?
Everyone can hear me. Okay, great. I think for me, in the context of Grangemouth, my view is that the town's sort of on the edge of this huge, successful industrial complex. But in recent decades, it maybe hasn't significantly benefited from that. And that's especially true in the pockets of deprivation that exist within the area. For example, Grangemouth has five areas within Scotland's 10% most deprived in Scotland. More people are dying younger in Grangemouth than in Falkirk and Scotland as a whole. And premature deaths from cancer and coronary heart disease are also higher. So there's a sort of tension there with a kind of place that's doing, you know, incredible, you know, successfully commercial things, and then a community that maybe isn't, benefiting. So I think for me now, as millions of pounds are about to be invested in transitioning the industrial complex towards a net zero future, it's important that Grangemouth and its community gets a fair share of those benefits. And in my mind, a just transition would be a point in the future where a green industrial complex offers high quality jobs to the workforce that has successfully reskilled from the existing industry that's there, and where corresponding investment in the local area means that Grangemouth community has improved opportunities for employment and a better quality of life. If I was being honest right now, I don't know that if I walked down Grangemouth, you know, town centre and said to people, what does just transition mean and what does it mean to you, that would be a something that everyone resonated with. So I think we collectively need to agree exactly what that just transition is. I've just given you my interpretation, but I'm not suggesting that mine is the one, you know. So I think we need to agree exactly what it is. And then I think there's a big job to try and articulate that to the local community. And Adam will be much better than myself to talk about that, about why that just transition is relevant to them. Because I know that consultation and engagement that was done with the community in the last sort of 3 to 4 years posed that question to them, and the feedback we got was that the just transition wasn't seemingly overly relevant to them. Maybe that's seen as there's a large industrial complex that's going to go from, you know, being a petrochemical to a hydrogen, what's in it for me sort of thing. But I think I don't want it to be negative. I think what we find with Grangemouth, in my view, is that there's so many exciting opportunities and potential. I think we just need to transition that into a delivery, so that people on the street, people in the community, actually see something happen and that we're making a big difference to their lives.
Okay, thank you. And Dermot, I'll come to you next. We received the paper yesterday. So you talk about a number of projects and things that are happening in Grangemouth, in particular Greener Grangemouth, which I think more people will maybe ask questions about. But in terms of, you know, is that the kind of key, in terms of delivering a just transition for Grangemouth, Is that where you're largely playing a role? And but do you think the public have an understanding of the projects that you're working on or what it actually means?
Yeah, absolutely. So I suppose maybe to take that in two ways, around what Just Transition is and then just some of the work. On the Just Transition piece itself, I think that there's two ways of looking at it at a community level. So the first way is maybe looking at the International Labour Organization definition of just transition around decent work. And they've kind of broken that down into four things. So decent work is about right opportunities, protection from harm, it's about protection of rights, and it's also about dialogue. So I think in a Grangemouth context, with the totality of infrastructure, investment and industry, those four bits seem really relevant around making more opportunity for the community, making sure there's more protection from the environmental context, making sure that there's more rights around environmental justice, and particularly around dialogue. So with Adam and other colleagues, we're in a consultation with the community last week around Greener Grangemouth, saying here's an amount of money from the growth deal, a capital investment and a revenue investment. That's good, but it's small. So with any money, it's always have its limitations. So with that money, the question is, what are we going to do with it? What are we going to do with 10 million capital and 2 million revenue in an area of transition? And the answer is to spend it wisely on what's needed, but also to use it to convene, coordinate and collect all of the other things that are happening around the area. So Greener Grangemouth is one small thing which will have a target of money, but its purpose really is to use that as a way of convening conversations with others so that the just transition in Grangemouth can be meaningful around three specific things. One is that the transition helps the community itself to build on its strengths and its capability. Two, that the place of Grangemouth itself is able to build structure and hope for the future. And fundamentally, I think, three, it's around the relationships and partnerships. So it's not just about spending the money we have now. It's about looking at how we use the totality of energy, capability, community and resources moving forward. So in our work is about the Greener Grangemouth work, yes. The Greener Grangemouth work is about a spend programme, yes. But partly the intent of that is to use it as an opportunity to convene.
Okay, thank you. And Adam, welcome to the committee. Do you want to say a bit about what you think a just transition means for Grangemouth and what success would look like? And the broadcasting will work the mic, so nobody has to worry about the microphone.
All right, okay. Thank you for having us here today. A just transition for Grangemouth. Historically, Grangemouth has seen probably an unjust transition, moving from a town that was one of the most prosperous in Europe to, if you look outside the industry now, you're looking at a town that looks like the industry has left. That's probably the best way in explaining that. We have had a lot of false stones as a community, and even we have engaged since back. I don't know if the committee's had a chance to see the consultation report that was published in 2019, 200-page document, which led to what we see as a watered-down version of the Community Action Plan. I was having a look at the Community Action Plan this morning and it still disappoints me, to be honest with you. A just transition would see Grangemouth prosper from the industry that is underlining the Scottish economy. We understand that sharing the benefits of Grangemouth is of national importance, but it feels, as a community, we have to accept the negatives of the industry. There is ideas, there is plans, I look at Freeport and things like that, where it's skilling up. We can't just have a local community that gets skilled up. It just doesn't work. We need something in between. We need to regenerate our town centre. But that's in not just spending money creating. It's about how our town operates for a net zero future. We attempted to diversify the community action plan that was more towards net zero, which at the centre of it was bringing rail to Grangemouth. Real engrangement would do a number of things, and it would allow legislation that's already been passed in this Parliament to make massive changes to Grangemouth. Sorry, I'm a wee bit nervous. First time I've been in the building. What we looked at was a plan that train station in Grangemouth, as I say, this was done, started 2018. A lot has changed in 5 years. The community action plan must change, and it must change dramatically to achieve what you, which we all want to want to see. A train station in Grangemouth would allow 20,000 new jobs to be sustainable. We can't replace chimneys that are causing this problem in the first place and replace them with 20,000 cars. A net zero, looking back at what's been invested in TIF, TIF funding has went to upgrade motorways. That doesn't scream we're looking at net zero here. Mm-hmm. We need better public transport. And we're not just talking about buses, we're talking about a mix. Now, what that can do is those 20,000 jobs, where by far the majority will not come to Grangemouth residents, we can offer public transport where people are actually filtered into our town centre, which regenerates our town centre, which creates jobs that do not need a lot of skilling up, which people could actually enjoy right now, which would make a difference in our community. Underlining that, we would look to have a parking levy, which is a legislation that was introduced in this Parliament, which at the moment I believe is only coming to Edinburgh and Glasgow. And this doesn't have to be Falkirk-wide, this can be Grangemouth community realising what is being offered to the Scottish economy with the 20,000 jobs. A net zero economy, if we seen 20,000 cars coming into our town, that would see an unjust transition. And to mitigate these things, realising the benefits and delivering what we're actually proposing, which would see free public transport around the area of Grangemouth, underlined by the parking levy, we would see the benefit of people not using cars. Mm-hmm. But as a community, it would also fund free public transport in our area. And to see a circular economy where we all benefit, that's how we would see a just transition to net zero.
OK, that's great. Thank you. I'm going to bring Michelle in, but if I just maybe come back to Malcolm. So, Malcolm, we were looking a bit at the Future Industries Board. The Grangemouth Future Industry Board. Are you the representative from the... Are you involved in the board?
And yeah, that's correct.
So do you want to just give a view on what the board, how it operates, whether it's is it effective in terms of bringing together the public partners, and what do you see as the priorities of the members of the board?
So Falkirk Council is a key player on the GFIB, Grangemouth Future Industries Board. I guess the group is collectively working to align public sector activity in the Grangemouth area. So it's all the different public sector agencies that typically are doing their own thing in a silo approach being brought into one space, and us trying to align where the shared priorities are and where we can each support each other. It's chaired by the Scottish Government and Scottish Enterprise. And in essence, bring together the key decision makers to promote investment, growth, innovation and competitiveness of the site. I think one of the key aspects from our perspective as a council is the Grangemouth Flood Protection Scheme, which I'm not sure how much the committee's familiar with, but... I've been thinking about, today in advance, and effectively, sea levels are rising, and Grangemouth is a place, the town and the complex, that would suffer from that rising sea level. It's absolutely essential that this huge piece of infrastructure is developed to protect Grangemouth residents and the complex and Scotland's future economy by through the protection scheme. And for us as a council, we're looking for this scheme to be progressed through government, because its current estimate is about £600 million. So the funding model for normal flood schemes would be that a council provides 20% of the capital investment and the Scottish Government provides 80%. But on a model of £600 million, there's no way as a council we can do that. So one of our priorities through the GFIB is to work with government partners and agencies to see that raised in profile, because for me there is no just transition for Grangemouth unless we ensure the long-term sustainability of the area. In terms of GFIB, if I was, you know, I've been in post for a year, so I can only talk about the time that I've been involved. I think that it's a novel thing. It's not something that has happened before. I think it's great that the Scottish Government is highlighting its priority for the Grangemouth area by, you know, setting up and establishing the board, committing manpower to it. We have spent probably a fair amount of time working out the governance arrangements because it's a new sort of entity. And I think we're now at that sort of tipping point where we need to start seeing the collectiveness of that group deliver something that would have happened, sorry, that wouldn't have happened if the group didn't exist. So, you know, it'd be unfair to say, has it been a success yet? Because it takes a while for the group to be established, for the governments to take control. But over the next year, we need to see some sort of outcomes from it that say, do you know what, if GFIB didn't exist, then that wouldn't have happened. And I know we'll probably come on to it in terms of, you know, what would we like to see change to sort of support a just transition. And I think maybe we could look at some sort of dedicated resource to GFIB, because at the moment it's individuals who have their normal jobs doing their normal jobs as well as GFIB. And you know, I'm not undermining that at all. You know, everyone's putting in a big amount of commitment, but I think some sort of dedicated resource to sort of be there, and maybe some sort of financial commitment. I guess the way the model works at the moment is we're all sat there with our own funding piles, mm-hmm. and we're wondering, can we collectively use our funding piles to do something different? But if we're maybe objective, you might say we're all struggling with our funding piles and competing priorities, so there's not that much great potential in us being able to sort of take some money from our pot and put it in collectively. I think some sort of seed funding investment into GFIB to give it some sort of financial muscle would maybe accelerate it. But I want to be positive about the board. Like I say, you know, it's a really welcome thing. And, you know, there aren't other places in Scotland where we have a board where it's collective, you know, public sector organisations all coming together. There's good, strong leadership. There's passion and interest. You know, the guys have been up to Falkirk and Grangemouth a couple of times. We're coming up. I think there's a visit happening in the next couple of months to see the flood protection scheme sites and where we're talking about. So I'm positive, but I think we need to now. It's again, it's back to my point about delivery. It's time to see something happen.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming along. I know my colleagues will want to come in with a lot of questions as well, but I kind of wanted to start in the centre, and I was so struck, Adam, by your submission, which I know from my own kind of personal representation absolutely strikes a chord in the heart of the community. And I'd particularly point out the issue around housing, because how can you attract people? There's insufficient housing, too many flats and so on. And I suppose what also struck me was the disconnect between the submission from Scottish Futures Trust, a lot of good stuff going on, and a lot of good stuff going on as well in the council. But from a local community point of view, what would you like to see happen that would ensure you feel you genuinely are at the heart of a community-centred just transition that can fan out with all the other good work going on? What would you like to see happen?
Words are easy, I believe. I think actions speak louder. You mentioned housing there, and I'll go back to a few weeks ago where we have Kingsey Avenue, which is an area that, that you'll be aware of. Flatted accommodation is an issue. If you live in a, if you have a job that's well paying, you don't want to live in a flat in Kingsey Avenue. As I say, actions speak louder. So when you look at, when you meet people for the council, you'll hear different things. When you see actions from different parts of the council, they don't match what's in the community action plan. They don't match what the people want to see. And I've had meetings with the head of council and I've asked them why? Why is it things are different in different areas of the Falkirk Council area that are in Grangemouth? And from the words of the community, what the community said, they've just put a sticky plaster or something to look, make it look nice. So the actions are not following what the community needs. And we can see that in different ways. Also from the planning system that's supposed to have protections for Grangemouth. If I go back to NPF3 when it mentions the community of Grangemouth who lives, has long lived in, with industry should be protected and enhanced. And yet just 2 weeks ago we see another HMO being given planning permission for Grangemouth, another one on the way, another one a week, the year before. This isn't the vision of what Community Action Plan's seen. And we're seeing this from different departments of the council. For example, education. Our children want to do advanced hires in Grangemouth High School. They're put in a taxi and they're moved away to another town to do the hires. Where do these actions say what? How do these actions actually prove that everybody is on board? Every part of the community, every part of the industry is saying the same thing. Sorry, I didn't get your second part there, only focused on the house.
No, you've probably given me enough to go on, but I want to bring in our other two witnesses as well to get your reflections on of the initiatives, many of which have already been put on the record, and we talked about the flood prevention, which I agree is very good around its comms. But from your perception, what would you like to see happening differently from your relative agencies that starts to square off this disconnect between the community and the perceptions so elegantly articulated and the activity that's going on just now, both short term and longer term?
Yeah, so I think a great point, and I think Adam, so we had a consultation with the community just last week and rightly said that the community action plan is a key vision for the community, but frustration on two levels. One, that it's watered down, and secondly, accountability to the vision. So if we're saying we're going in this way, it's how everyone works around it. So I guess from our point of view in Scottish Futures Trust, it's interesting just to look at what's going on within the community. So the Fringe of Inchara that Adam is in, the Zetland Park project, the Charlotte Das Heritage Trail, all of these initiatives are community-led and passionately led. And they tend to work around very specific local areas. So it tends to be that a bunch of people organise around a particular area and a different bunch of people organise around a different part of the town. So for me, what would be really good is that we're able to get more coordination between the good stuff happening within the community. Secondly, that us as agencies and departments and portfolios are also able to coordinate so that the totality of spend kind of works in a really interesting way. And the third one, I suppose, is to bridge that small-scale stuff, passionate and powerful, and the big-scale stuff. So to touch on the Grangemouth Future Industries Board for a second, I think it's important not to underestimate how difficult it is to get a conversation between disparate groups around a shared future. So to Malcolm's point, it actually takes a lot of time to get people to work. But as people are doing that, they tend to focus on what they know. So we'll focus on the industry. We'll focus on the complex. But there's a whole load of people just adjacent to that, 17,000 odd. So I think one of the other bits that would be really good is to see more relationship between the two parts, between the big and the small. And I know that the Just Transition team in Scottish Government are kind of trying to progress the Just Transition plan. And one of the questions that they asked us in SFT was, well, what are the links then? what are the links between the big stuff and the small stuff, between life that Adam's laying out and the bits. So we've had a go at thinking about that. And we think there's seven. So the first one is that there is a piece of work that SEPA are progressing called a regulatory hub, which is trying to look at aligned regulatory environment around Health and Safety Executive, around SEPA itself, around Nature Scot. So how does all that come together so that it facilitates the transition to future industries, but also that it protects and supports the community? So slightly invisible stuff at one level, but really important on the now, the next, and the later. So the regulatory hub bit is really important, so that an explicit intent of that is absolutely to support all of the work that Adam has said. And the explicit intent bit is the important thing. Mm-hmm. Not maybe, not hopefully, not supposedly, explicitly. Yeah. Second is that, and as Adam has rightly said, and the Community Action Plan has highlighted, it's not just about reskilling, it's about skills generally and passion generally, which the community has. So a key touch point is around employability and enterprise. So the enterprise around women, families, the existing businesses that are there, supply chains, community wealth building. Thirdly, around the active travel bit. So the rail is an ambition of the community, absolutely. But meanwhile, while the business case for that goes through, while the stag and all of that goes through, that could take a number of years. Meanwhile, we could be looking at improving the walking environment, the cycling environment. Meanwhile, we could be looking at the electric vehicle capacity. Meanwhile, we could be looking at the integration of active travel to Falkirk Grahamston and down to the industrial cluster, benefiting the community. Fourthly, around the Greenport and also the transition to future industries, logistic and freight will be a key issue, massive issue. It's an issue now, it's going to be an issue later, so there's huge opportunities. So how do we think about that in a coordinated way, so some of the hassle is taken away from the community and some of the efficiencies move into the cluster? There's incredible skill in Grangemouth, incredible skill at community level to mobilise people in situations which seem hopeless, incredible skill in industry to transition to huge and different futures, incredible skill. So what if we shared the skills? What if we were able to take some of the skills from the industry and start to apply that for how we might look at an energy and heat network? Not necessarily pay for it, but look at what are the things we can do, what are the skills we can apply, what are the potentials we can apply, and how can we test that out? The next one is around the NPF implementation. So NPF is here. It's right here, as Adam has rightly said. So the question isn't about whether we need it anymore. The question is what we're going to do with it. And that is a question for the industrial cluster. It's a question for the flood scheme, and it's a question for the community. So a shared interest between the parts is the implementation of policy, not the construction of it. And the final one is around the flood defence scheme, which I think is really interesting, and some of the financial bits that Malcolm's laid out also invite some really difficult choices. So how do you protect, and who do you protect, and how does it all go? But within those choices, there's massive opportunities. There's massive opportunities on data infrastructure to make sure the flooding works. There's massive opportunities on nature-based systems to make sure it kind of supports. And those opportunities could flow into the community to enhance exactly the points that Adam's talked about. So I suppose to your point, Michelle, part of it is around us collectively trying to work out the different touch points at the different scales. Adam and his community are right at the heart of it, and they know what's going on in the community. The Grangemouth Futures Industries Board are trying to kind of get that to work. And then there's a bridge in between that we need to be really targeted on and explicit on, so that the benefits flow to the community, but also the transition happens up front. And I think that is a job of government on a coordination bit. It is a job of agencies on the implementation side. And fundamentally, it's a job of all of us to be accountable, to listen and work with the communities.
So a very, very fulsome answer. And I want to hear from Malcolm yourself as well. And feel free to bring in the GFIB as well if you want to comment about that.
Thanks. There's a bit of me that sort of feels wrong answering the question, because Adam's, the community. If it's my opinion, and I feel like what we're hearing from the community is, can we see something change? can something change? Because otherwise it feels like we're just hearing words. And the two levers that I feel like we as a council can pull is town centre regeneration and housing. The two are quite closely linked. I think we need to recognise that the Grangemouth town centres, I'm talking about the shopping area and that sort of, you know, really small inner ring type approach, that's failing and needs to be reborn, if you like. So I want to get a master plan done for the Grangemouth sort of town centre area that kind of identifies where we can remove some empty units, remove maybe sort of aged housing and replace it with new modern housing that meets the requirements of the community. And I think what I've heard from the surveys that we've done with residents is that, you know, they want more family accommodation in the area that allows people to stay and not just transition through Grangemouth to somewhere else and have high turnover rates. So create a kind of sustainable kind of neighbourhood. And I think that's something that we could achieve. And I know Dermot's, you know, leading some of that work with the 10 million Greener Grangemouth activity that we've got. And then I'll work with my colleagues in housing to see what we can do. You know, I've got information about some of the early housing projects, but for me, they aren't on a scale that would be significant enough to really, you know, allow me to say to Adam, don't worry, it'll be okay on the, you know, in a few years, it's going to be looking different. So that's that. I just want to touch as well that as a council, everyone will be familiar that we represent all sorts of communities within the Falkirk area. And it's interesting because some communities feel that Grangemouth gets sort of more than they do, you know, and, you know, other communities in Falkirk would say, well, we're not getting a committee about us, we're not getting an industrial complex. So there's always a tension there. But, you know, I recognise the importance of Grangemouth as a complex, both for the, you know, Falkirk wider area and the sort of Scotland PLC, if you like. And it is essential that the residents and communities do get some sort of benefit from that, because, you know, we haven't touched on things like HGV drivers and the impacts that those guys have on the community. Something's got to happen that makes people feel like they get something out of it. So to come back to the point, town centre regeneration and housing would be my two areas of focus, but I would also seek to work much more closely with Adam to sort of make sure that those are the things he wants to see, or his communities want to see.
So just last wee question before I give over to the next person. There's a perception, which you've already alluded to in Grangemouth, that they, as a community, bear the cost of the industry without getting the value of it. And there's a perception held by some people that the council doesn't give sufficient focus, that actually, inadvertently, its focus will go to things that protect industry. And they would make an argument that even the flood defences are about protecting industry rather than necessarily having the community at the heart. That's a perception that I've been aware of since I was elected to represent the area. Do you think that's changed? And what active steps has the council taken as part of your activities around a just transition to address that? Because you're clearly aware of that perception yourself.
Yeah, so I think, and forgive me, I can't remember if it was the submission from the community council that went to the committee, but, you know, if you read that, that there is a narrative about how, you know, if we went 60, 70 years ago to the Grangemouth, then there was direct money going from Grangemouth into the local area, and you only need to see the municipal investment along the, you know, kind of town centre area to see all these buildings that were created. To see how the community would have benefited in those days, whereas now in a kind of larger council environment, that sort of direct return doesn't exist. So it's not a perception. You know, anyone who must have lived there for 50 years will know the difference between what happens now and what used to happen. What I would say is if we pick up the flood protection scheme, there's lots of investment as part of that scheme that isn't just at the seaport, it's up the river, you know, into neighbourhoods. So I think the scheme will address all sorts of issues beyond just business. But, you know, I think it's all about perception and whether people feel like that would be happening if business wasn't there, you know, and I get that point. I think in terms of how do we change it? Grangemouth is very fortunate. I can list some of them, but you know, we know that INEOS are going to spend £1 billion on hydrogen transitioning. You know, we've got the growth deal. The Green Freeport announcement for me is really exciting. You know, we're talking about £6 billion worth of investment coming in, a lot of that coming to the Grangemouth area. There's just no way that there isn't going to be some spillover, although I accept that the fear is that some of the jobs, or a lot of the jobs that are created for people who drive into Grangemouth rather than for the local community. But the one of the key work streams within the Green Freeport is a skills development piece about creating virtual reality simulation training, and it's absolutely dedicated on deprived communities and seeking to sort of support people in those communities to get that training. So I feel really sort of excited, but again, it's a bit kind of jammed tomorrow, isn't it? You know, if for Adam to sort of hear, you don't worry, you know, the Green Freeport's coming, you know, it's about that thing, we need to see it now. The tax increment finance scheme, I accept, again, won't transform communities, but the investment in infrastructure helps to make Grangemouth a sustainable place for business, which means that the businesses don't leave Grangemouth, which help to keep jobs as much as we can in the local area. The protection scheme will hopefully give us a long-term future for the area. The GFIB, again, should tie in lots of public sector organisations to deliver some sort of change. And so I think there are, you know, if I think, have I got a drawer with things in my drawer that are going to make things different for Grangemouth? I do believe that there are there, but again, it's about taking it, stop being words and make something actually happen. But I think we definitely can. And you know, like the growth deal, I can go into more detail later in the committee, but you know, there's a series of projects there that I think are really exciting and will make a difference.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Smith, be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I follow up on the points you've made about the various initiatives that have taken place? I had a list here before I started the meeting, and I've just added to the list of different initiatives. So you've got you've got the Green Freeport, which you mentioned there, Malcolm. You've got the local hydrogen action plan. You've got the Falkirk growth deal. You've got UK government's Levelling Up agenda, shared prosperity fund, Scottish government's national strategy of economic transformation. You just mentioned, Malcolm, you'd like to see a master plan for the Grangemouth area. That the letter we got from SFT this morning talked about the Greener Grangemouth initiative. There's a lot of initiatives out there. How can conflict between the various policy programmes and initiatives be properly managed to ensure that we've got a joined up working towards our goal? I don't know,
so. It's a good question. I probably would say that there, well, I would say that because I'm going to try and be positive, but you know, I think there is really good linkages between the two. So if I take the growth deal and the Green Freeport, so we're the obviously the accountable body for the growth deal, but Falkirk Council is also the accountable body for the Green Freeport, which means that we're the public sector body, because obviously the Green Freeport's a partnership between Edinburgh Council, yeah, Fife Council and Falkirk Council, and Falkirk Council's the accountable body, the one that receives the money and needs to divvy up the money and run the kind of governance of the two. So we're kind of in a really, you know, good position to align the two schemes. But if you look at the key priorities of the two sort of programmes, if you like, they're really closely linked about business innovation and also placemaking and improvement in learning and training. So I feel confident about the alignment with things like that. Obviously, the £1 billion investment by INEOS into the, you know, transitioning of the complex, that's not something that as a council will have much or any say over, but it's a green transition which fits.
How do you manage that if there's a potential conflict with what INEOS are saying and what you're wanting to achieve as a local council?
I don't think there is a conflict, because that investment is about investing in hydrogen and green energy, and if I take examples within the growth deal, two of the work streams are about identifying incubator hubs, if you like, for exciting new ways of using energy and exciting ways of carbon utilisation to sort of reduce carbon emissions. So the two are actually, you know, working towards the same end. The announcement by INEOS to go for that green transition was a really positive signal for Falkirk Council, you know, because we've got aspirations to see carbon reduction happen across the Falkirk area. And now the largest emitter in our area and one of the largest in Scotland's going to go on that same journey. So I'm confident that there is good alignment. I think I hear the point that you make in terms of there's all sorts of different programs and how does one person stay on top of them, or how does an organization make sure you don't maybe lose priority of which one's the most important one to go on. But I feel confident in my view that, you know, everything actually does join together. But
is there a need for, I'm not going to suggest another committee or anything, another group, because you've got quite a lot already. You talked earlier about the Futures Board, but is there a need for more coordination?
If I'm being honest, I can only say my own sort of sense, and I don't get that. I probably should have said INEOS are represented on the Falkirk Growth Deal Board.
They're not on the Industry Future Board, for example. It's just public sector is on that.
On GFIB, yeah, for sure. But I would say, you know, Growth Deal's backed by £130 million of investment. The Green Freeport's going to have £6 billion worth of investment. So those are the areas where probably I'd be drawn to. GFIB, for me, is a vehicle by which we seek to make sure that if we talk about like the regulatory hub happening in Grangemouth, that we're all aware of the regulatory hub. We're all thinking, how can we maximise the benefits of the regulatory hub? That's the vehicle for GFIB. And as I said earlier, because there isn't any additional financial investment in GFIB, I'd be more drawn to the importance of the Growth Deal and the importance of the Green Freeport, if I was ranking them in priorities in terms of what's going to change the lives of people in the Grangemouth area.
And Dermot, you obviously touched on several initiatives. It was almost, you looked as if you were trying to coordinate all this.
Yeah, and I think there is a lot of coordinate. You know, on the Growth Deal Board, a lot of the representatives that sit on that from the public sector also sit on the Grangemouth Future Industries Board. Literally the same people sit on the board, you know. So I think there's a lot of people moving around. I would say that we don't need new boards and groups. I think there's three things that can help the alignment that Malcolm's set out. One is around spending. So on the Growth Deal with the Greener Grangemouth, I think there's an opportunity to get early spend to address some of the priorities that Malcolm, that Adam has set out, you know, so around the town centre and the housing, we can get things to happen now so we can start to deliver on that. The second, and in the submission that we've presented with the Greener Grangemouth work, we've been trying to kind of set out six principles that can work across all these various bits and pieces. So whether you're the Grangemouth Futures Industries Board, or whether you're the Greenport, or whether you're the TIF or whoever it might be in the area, is to ask six questions before you do a thing, before you consult. So what role actually is there for the community? How is it building the capacity of the community? How is it enhancing the well-being of the community? How does it transform the local economy? How does it enhance the environment? And particularly, how does the investment in infrastructure deliver some of the inclusive growth things? So one of the important bits around coordination is that there's a kind of a similar stickiness, if you like. So there's some similar things. And the last bit is around measures. Actually, so I think that if we collectively keep ourselves accountable, you know, to what we're trying to do in Grangemouth, if all the various different initiatives measure themselves in a very similar way, then there's a way of making sure that whatever you do, it has to hit these bits. So I would say the three things that are useful around the spending now, around the aligned principles and the measures. And I think that there are tools of coordination out there. There's the NPF and its implementation. There's the local development plan and its delivery focus. And there's the growth deal and its delivery focus at the strategic board, the local board, and individual projects. So I think all of the ingredients are there. It's within all of those ingredients to make sure that we're hitting the ground in the community now, that we're aligning up the ducks around that, and then we're measuring ourselves and keeping each other accountable. So I think all of that should be done within the forums and structures we have first. And if it turns out that, you know, there's stresses and strains within that, then by all means kind of move it on. But I think that by doing it that way, that's partly one of the ways where we can surface the conflicts. There's different groups where we can start to surface it, test it out, and then bring it forward and say, look, we need to talk in a different way about how we'd resolve those issues.
I'm going to bring Adam in to give the viewpoint of, in a second, about whether the community feel they're involved in these initiatives. But I'll maybe get you to get your rebuttal in first, Dermot. How do you involve the community? Because I detect from the delivery of the action plan, there's a lot of frustration from the community that a lot of things are happening, but it's not benefiting the community. So how are you bringing the community into that?
That is the fundamental nub of this, isn't it? So the Greener Grangemouth project, I think, is unique in the deal in that it's entirely focused on the community. So it's about putting community wellbeing into the heart of the just transition. And what we haven't done is to present to the community of Grangemouth, here's four or five things that we're going to spend the money on. What we have done is to try and engage with the community on the back of the community action plan to ask three questions. One is, what should we spend? Two is, how should we work together? Which becomes important, not just in the planning of it, but also in the doing of it. And three, then, how should we connect this with the wider bits? So part of what we're trying to do in the Greener Grangemouth bit is to set up the idea of a mini programme, so to speak, a community focused programme that builds on the work that Adam has been talking about, that builds on the work that Mark has been talking about. And from that, we identify a long list of possibilities, a short list of possibilities, and then we're getting into the targeting. We're kind of going, right, so we're going to do this. And then once we've done this, we're going to try and wrap things around it. And once we've wrapped things around it, we're going to get people to kind of wrap around even more. So the Greener Grangemouth, at its heart, is a community partnership project. It's not about us SFT telling the community what to do, but it is about SFT saying, if this is what we want to do, we can help make that happen.
And Adam, I mean, Greener Grangemouth sounds like a great thing, community heavily involved in that. What way do you think the community could be better involved in some of this work?
Well, you mentioned a few committees there. The non-industrial side, Grangemouth, isn't represented in these communities. I think that's a loss for what they're trying to deliver. For the reason is, no disrespect, this can tell you everything you want, but when you discuss making changes, only the people that live there, I believe, can understand how these changes affect. Now, what I'm trying to say is, if you were involved in these committees and you're having these discussions, it's not about trying to stop development, it's about mitigating development so that it's more appealing to the local people, if you like. The community links report showed that there was a distrust between council, industry, non-industry. And having these committees segregated from the community, I don't believe helps.
How would you like to see that change? Do you think community council should be on more of these committees, or do you think that there's a need for a structure that brings some of these different organisations we've got and initiatives got with the community? How would you bring that together? How would you align the community with all these initiatives that are taking place?
As you already alluded to yourself, there's a lot of committees there, and it's, if you imagine, we're a group of 10 people that all we all have our own full-time jobs and things like that, so it's hard to commit to that. I believe that we should be given the option. We've always believed that we should actually be in the room when decisions are being made, for at least our opinion on how decisions are made. And I think we should have a representation on anything that affects our community, especially when we have what we call the permitted planning zone, which is in the port complex, which will be expanded once we have Greenport. These decisions will be forced upon us. We won't have a choice to. We know that the planning system isn't perfect. It's going to be weakened in Grangemouth. That's going to be a disadvantage to the community. So I think we should be represented wherever possible on these committees to have these discussions. We have managed, I'll not say it's all been one-sided, we have managed through Falkirk Council, we have managed to have meetings with, well, indirectly with the GFIB board, where we've actually seen what they have been discussing and things like that. But it would be much better to be in the room to give a community perspective what they're discussing and how it affects the community, because I don't believe industry has a full view, if you like, or the council. And I think having a position on these committees would be important and be beneficial for everybody, I think.
It's quite I used to be a community councillor before I was a local councillor, before I was an MSP. It's quite a big commitment for you guys, though. I mean, I used to go to lots of organisations, and you'll know there's loads out there. Is that asking too much of your community council members, or is there another way, or do you think just actually that open invitation should be there for the community council to go to these different organisations?
I agree with what you're saying. We discuss that we're probably the most consulted community in Scotland. We like to have that theme. It certainly feels like it. We can't go to everything. Mm-hmm. We have to decide what's important. We have no choice in that. We don't have the resources to go to everything.
But the option should be there, yeah?
Yes, I believe so, yeah.
Finished, thank you. Graham Simpson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Yeah, thanks. So I've covered a lot of ground already. I'm just going to follow up with you, Adam, on the Colin Smith's line of questioning. And I was just thinking, you know, community councils, they come in all shapes and sizes, and some are really effective, some are not that effective. And, you know, I think you've said, you know, if you were to be invited to every single organisation, which we've already had a long list of them, that would really, really, really stretch you. And surely I would have thought, you know, Colin and myself have both been councillors. Surely it's the job of councillors to attend these things and feed back to you if you can't get along. Would you agree with that?
Well, I believe councillors should be there. Of course they should. That's why they're elected. Even when it comes to that, I would agree with that in principle. But then I believe the details of such meetings should be shared openly.
Yeah.
And that isn't always the case.
Yeah.
We have some good councillors in Grangemouth, and they do share some information with us. But it's not always open, if you like.
Yeah, I think that's a fair point. Dermot, I just want to... I mean, you've mentioned Greener Grangemouth. I'm still not really clear in my head what it actually is. Could you perhaps explain what Greener Grangemouth is?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's a subset of the Falkirk and Grangemouth growth deal. It's a 10 million capital project and 2 million revenue. So the money is 10 million capital, 2 million revenue. The purpose of it is, as I said, to focus on community well-being and community partnership. And within it, we think there are three kinds of projects that the money could go towards. First, town centre projects, so to pick up on Malcolm's point around the regeneration. Mm-hmm. Secondly, within the community, and the Community Action Plan has highlighted it, there are a number of areas of deprivation where life is not as good as it could be or should be. And they include Kersey Bank, Bow Houses, and then the top of Carron Grange. And within those areas, we think that some of the 10 million can try and make life a little easier, but also make opportunities more accessible. So there's an infrastructure of community facilities already there. How can we look at that being more net zero? How can we bring more digital infrastructure into it? How can we connect it in so some of the skills programmes that Malcolm's talked about from the Greenport are accessible through Kersey Bank, Bow Houses and Carron Grange, not Falkirk, not somewhere else. So the youngsters in that area are able to get into it and get there. The third bit is that on the revenue side, that is entirely about net zero capacity building in the community. So it's about investing in the community and building within it. And I suppose around that, there's a number of different possibilities. So skills and training would be part of that, but also around organisational capacity to build on the kind of questions that you've been laying out. So if we are looking at a future which is more community-led, and if the community are, you know, some really great and some needing help, then we've got an opportunity to invest over 10 years in strengthening the capability to lead, strengthening the sustainability bits on it, so that we're not investing in something that has no chance of lasting for 2 year or 5 year or whatnot. It's more we're investing in the people, we're investing in the stuff, we're investing in the outcomes. So if you bring all of that together, it's a portfolio of projects trying to make a difference on the ground.
Okay. And I guess we're right at the start of that journey, are we?
We're right at the start of it.
None of the projects have been done.
No, so and that's an important bit, is that I think that, you know, Adam and the community and Walter Ingalls also in the community have been through many consultations. There is much stuff in many documents, so it's not that hard to go and find it. So our job is to go read it and then distill it down and saying that the long list of potential things that all this stuff says seems to look like this. And then working with the community then to bring that down into a short list. So the business case process of the deal moves in summertime, where UK and Scottish Government have an expectation to see some of that progressed. So our job is to push the OBC, the outline business case for the Greener Grangemouth, so that there's coherence on it, structure on it, and that that allows the business case to be approved. I suppose just to pick up on one bit, just on the last line of questioning around councillors and representation and the capacity, we're also working in SFT in other parts of Scotland, and so one of them is in Borderlands. So it has a place programme, so it's trying to look at each town what's needed. And what's interesting in that project is that they're building the idea of a community board or a town team which has representation across. And recently we're in Hoyk, and I think there's about 83 different community groups and community, including community councils and members. So there's huge amounts, but you can imagine one group might have four people or meet whatever. What was amazing in that particular community is somebody mapped all of it, categorised all of it, and then suggested how a representative board structure could work with representatives that talk to it. So I thought it was an excellent way of understanding the dynamic of the community, also about building accountability from the ground, but having a board structure, if you like, that's the Grangemouth Future Community Board of sorts, that allows a strategic interaction, you know, on the community interests, but also on the political interests, and then on the wider bit. So I think that there is learning that we can rob, to be honest, from other places and invest in Grangemouth.
Well, that would be yet another committee.
I suppose the corollary of that is your point on time stretched. So if it's representative, then we're making sure that the voices of the community are represented and there's feedback back into the communities, as opposed to making demands on community to be at every single meeting and not being able to attend it. So sure, some way of getting the collective voice to work.
I mean, you were saying earlier the people on the Future Industry Board are the same people that are on the growth deal. Do we need a Future Industry Board? I mean, have any comments on that?
I think we do. I think we do, because the growth deal has a particular agenda and set of remits, and then the Future Industries Board has similar people, but I suppose, like your own committees and your own work, it'll be the same person doing different things with different people for different reasons. So on the Future Industries bit in itself, I think that the work there is about convening people, it's about shaping the trajectory, and then it's about keeping people together, whereas the deal bit is about lining up the ducks for spending and investing. So kind of slightly different, but I think the opportunity is that there are similar people who know the area, who are able to move in and out of the groups. The challenge, I suppose, is that those different people use that time efficiently and connect up all of the ducks in the different forums that they're in.
Okay, final question from me. We're going to get another report, you'll be pleased to know, and another consultation. That will be the government's Just Transition Plan, which has been mentioned already. What do you think? Well, first, I suppose my question is: do you think is there a point to this? Is there a point to having a Just Transition Plan? I'll address this to you, Malcolm, because Dermot's had a good run there. And what should be in it? Shouldn't just be in, as Adam said, just words. It will need to actually set out some actions and projects and timescales. You've already mentioned it. You know, there are lots of ideas out there, but for me, that plan should be, that's what it should be. It should be, this is what we need. This is how much it'll cost. This is how we're going to get there. Is that how you would see it?
I think that I think it should exist, because I think if it didn't, we might not have these conversations. And I think these conversations, as you've heard from Adam, are absolutely essential to make sure that we don't just get drawn to the significant industrial and economic benefits of this area, and there'll be other similar sites across Scotland that will need to go through the same journey and make sure that there is some benefit for the local community. So I fully support it. In terms of what that final plan strategy is going to include, I'm not sure. I need to, you know, I need to see it. I guess if the question was put to me, what do I want to see for Grangemouth in terms of a just transition, then it would be things like a financial commitment to the Grangemouth flood protection scheme, maybe some sort of financial or employee commitment to the GFIB, flexibility within government for some of the schemes and funding that we're being given, such as the growth deal and tax increment finance, to allow us to flex and move with what's quite a changing sort of economic situation in terms of construction inflation and just whether ideas are the right ideas. If you want to change horse, then there's a sort of level of bureaucracy that comes with that to change projects. I think targeted investment in employability and training schemes linked to sort of green industry, personally some sort of dedicated funding for social housing in these communities, because I think that is the barrier at the moment in terms of certainly unlocking significant investment in social housing in Grangemouth at the moment.
Thank you very much. Colin Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, I'd like to pick up on something in the Scottish Futures Trust, which Malcolm has actually just mentioned, which is TIF. And I thought that was a real blast from the past. I remember when it was extremely popular and flavour of the month, and everybody seemed to be reaching for it, and then suddenly it was less popular, and I don't know if it completely died out, but you don't hear of it anymore. Dermot, you've put it in your submission here about TIF. Do you want to make some comment on that as to how it fits in?
I guess what's interesting about Grangemouth is it's a jigsaw of different pieces from different times, if you like. So the TIF work was the tax increment finance was around trying to get finance in to build infrastructure, and that programme is still progressing. The development of the TIF work across Scotland has included things like the Growth Accelerator model, which has supported some of the work here in Edinburgh, or the Green Growth Accelerator model, which are trying to get finance to invest in new and different behaviours. So the TIF model is still there. There's still negotiations ongoing with Falkirk Council and Scottish Government. And part of that is about looking at some of the strategic infrastructure that facilitates the transition to industry and then some of the infrastructure needs in the area. So it's still there. I guess that the issue then is looking at different mechanisms in that transition. That's one tool in the box, but there'll be other tools in the box to bring in finance and funding for infrastructure.
To be honest, I'm not sure why it kind of went out of fashion. It just seemed to vanish from people's sight. Do you know why that happened?
I don't think it vanished. I mean, I think there's a number of different factors. So there's a range of TIF projects across Scotland, and a bit like the discussion we had about whether you need the Growth Board and the Just Transition Board, TIF in itself asks people to invest time to get the business case to work, to get the partnerships to kind of work. So it needs time. All of these mechanisms needs time. And I think over the period that local authorities and governments, time's pressured. So I think that's one of the issues around just kind of getting the time investment in it. I think the second bit that's kind of come forward around some of the models is then just looking at the intent of some of the models. So the Green Growth Accelerators is a good example where it's taking similar principles, but then migrating that onto more of the greener outcomes. So still there, still progressing, still very much part of the portfolio of the infrastructure here, and there's still learning that's going on across the TIF projects about how it can be improved, some of the issues and sticking points within it.
Malcolm, do you have anything you want to add there?
Yes. I've worked in local government for 13 years, so I don't have as much experience maybe as even some of you on the panel, but I feel like local authorities can be traditional beasts, and that means that we're used to getting some capital money from government, we're used to using revenue to raise capital money, and then TIF comes along and people go, ooh, that's a bit different, right, so how does this work? And also there's a risk attached to it, because if you don't then generate the rates revenue, then you as a council are liable. So as an officer, you have to have a risk appetite to go down that route, because effectively you are advising the council to spend a lot of money on something which you can't guarantee will deliver a return, and that could have a financial consequence on the council. So I don't have a knowledge of why other councils wouldn't have done it, but obviously as an officer now sitting trying to execute a TIF scheme, when we enter the, you know, tax increment finance meeting, it's a different space for us, and we're sort of having different conversations. We're challenging business rate information. We're projecting, is that site going to actually become a hotel? Is that site actually going to generate the revenue? And it makes people anxious. It makes people think, I want more kind of reassurance. And if I was making a broad generalisation, I would say that would be my interpretation of why, you know, TIF hasn't sort of been grabbed at by others. But that's not to say I don't think it has its merits. We are still looking to pursue the TIF sort of investment in Falkirk. But again, the lifespan of the TIF is a set amount of years that you do your contract with the council, sorry, with the Scottish Government. And pace, I think, is something that needs to happen. And because there hasn't maybe been as much pace since we signed the TIF, you start losing some of the years that you had banked in to get that revenue back. So now the funding model doesn't look as generous. It now looks more marginal, and therefore the risk of me presenting to council becomes more marginal. But it's still a viable scheme, and it's still one that I think people are happy to consider if there isn't another, you know, alternative.
That's interesting. Adam, I don't know the extent to which you might have been involved in any of the TIF projects.
Ironically, before I was a community councillor, Michelle, your predecessor, actually went into his office because as a member of the community, it actually frustrated me, because I've seen how other communities use TIF. It actually highlights part of the problem we've had in the community, because, as Malcolm rightly says, you need a stag report for a train station. TIF could have been used for that. We don't just have industry and community, we also have retail in Grangemouth, which has seen no support whatsoever. And this plan that I was talking about, that we tried to get implemented into the community action plan, it's actually no different to what is happening in our neighbouring town of Falkirk, where they're actually wanting to move the headquarters into the town centre to bring people into the town centre. Grangemouth's the exact same, except we would want to do it with industrial employees, 20,000, and it's trying to use that, which would then regenerate our town centre, brings footfall through. That then creates jobs that are more relevant to our community. So what you're saying is, right, we never had a lot to do with TIF. Certainly no, with the planning side of it, I believe that was, we weren't allowed to have any discussions in that. But I believe it could have been used in different ways, it'd have been more inclusive to the community.
Thank you. That was just a kind of an aside I picked up on the submission. But the key thing I wanted to ask you about was local businesses in the broad sense. The committee have heard that generally among employers, uncertainty is affecting investment decisions in infrastructure and training. Business likes certainty. Business likes to know what the plan is and what's coming down the road. What do you think are the major barriers against providing this certainty which businesses need in order to make those investments? Malcolm, can I maybe start with you?
My personal view would be a vision and a narrative, like what is happening in Grangemouth, what is Grangemouth going to look like in 5 years' time, and If I think about my drawer, I don't have that in my drawer at the moment that says, by the way, this is how it's going to look. And but as I sit here now, I will get there. I will mobilise our council's team to make sure that working with the community, we come up with a new Grangemouth, because I'm not going to leave the town centre like that. That town centre needs a committed action plan. Adam references the new Falkirk Town Hall and how we're transitioning that to fix Falkirk's town centre. That was kind of priority one in my intro on coming into the job. We're getting really close to being able to do that. Grangemouth will be very high up next on the list in terms of let's try and fix the town centre. So that to me, I feel, you know, you've heard from Adam, a sense of lots of talk, what's happening, the housing's not right, the town centre is not quite right, the public transport doesn't feel right, but what's going to change that? And I think it's about us saying, right, well, I've gone away and I've suggested that we get £20 million of capital investment to do X, Y, and Z, and once the community are involved, once they've endorsed that, then we move forward. And I think we have talked quite a lot about community involvement on boards, and I totally get the point that's being made in terms of it's not doing things to the community, but I think at the same time, some structures are in place that almost need to happen to generate ideas that then come back to the community without them being involved in meetings every month, often which has detail in it that I don't know that would be accessible allow the community to get what they want. What they want, in my view, is us to come and say, we've heard what you said in your surveys, we've designed a proposed model, here it is, does that look like the sort of thing that you're after? And then the community can say, well, you know, I don't think there's enough social housing there, or I don't think that the transport network looks like it, right, okay, we'll go away and refine it and come back. And that's the sort of relationship that I would be looking to try and create. But if that isn't the one that Adam and residents of Grangemouth want, then I'm happy to talk about that as well.
Clearly, a vision has to be a collective one, all the stakeholders involved. But on whose desk is the responsibility for ultimately delivering that?
I'd say it sits with myself as Director of Place for Falkirk Council to come up with a placemaking solution for the Grangemouth area. We will do it. You know, we will come up with that vision and we will have a proposed funding. Well, we'll have a model that says it will cost this to do it, and then we'll work out how we go and get the money. And maybe that will be discussions with Scottish Government. Maybe it will be trying to draw down some funding from the fourth Green Freeport investment. Maybe it will be somehow trying to use some of the growth deal money. We will find a way, at least, that there's a proposition that says, if you want to fix the town centre and make things better for the community, this is what you would do, and these are the costs that would be attached to that.
Adam, is it simply a lack of vision that's causing local businesses to be hesitant? Is that in itself an answer?
A lack of vision. It's a difficult one to answer, to be honest with you. I wouldn't say it's a lack of vision. I would possibly say there's definitely a divide between industry and community, and it feels communities. I struggle to say community because I would try and look at community as on both sides, if you want, because we are one Grangemouth. I'm not sure. I struggle to answer that one. I struggle to answer it.
Okay. Dermot?
I think there are visions. There are visions, so kind of bringing that together would be a helpful bit. But I think from your question around business in particular and that certainty bit, I think there are three things that can and are helping business. So one are early wins, and so that's about deploying some of the growth deal money quickly and purposefully so that people can see that there's stuff happening, so physical stuff happening. I think the second one is demand signals. So when COVID obviously hit the economy. One of the bits of work that SFT and others were involved in was around the Construction Leaders Forum to reassure that sector that there are things happening, there are things coming, and there are things being planned. And that generated what was called a construction pipeline, which was a visibility of the portfolio of different projects going on. And it's a simple tool, but actually really important, because it shows people there's a lot of stuff now. Here are the entry points into that lot of stuff, but more importantly, what happens next. So if I'm a business and I'm investing in that stuff now, what's the confidence that there's going to be something after it and something after it and something after it? And I think that's partly then to do with the third part, is around the additionality and the opportunities. And that's where forums like the Grangemouth Futures Industries Board are so important, to say if we are moving in this direction around carbon capture, if we're moving in this direction around hydrogen, if we're moving in this direction, then here are what are some of the opportunities that look like. So you can plan for that, you can see the opportunities right now, and you can get reassurance on the early wins. I would say what's interesting in Grangemouth is that the industrial and business structure is quite interesting, because there's a lot of deep relationships in small and medium enterprises that have stayed around the area. There's also some quite big regional and national entities kind of moving around the area. So there's a lot of businesses that have stayed there for a long time. And so that's quite interesting in that area, who are always watching and talking and moving around. So there's a good deep base, I think, with that good deep base to build a certainty, early wins, confidence signals, and then access to those future opportunities.
And just one last question, which I'll ask you to comment on. What more could or should be done by either the Scottish Government or the UK Government? Malcolm, maybe you'd like to...
With the risk of repeating myself, I think what I want to see is that financial commitment to the flood protection scheme, which I appreciate is a huge infrastructure, national piece of infrastructure that the Scottish Government needs to take appropriate time to sort of identify and work through. I think that potential for financial commitment to GFIB, flexibilities around the growth deal funding and TIF to help us maximise those opportunities, targeted investment and employability and training schemes so that they maximise the opportunities that are going to come from this green industry transition, and I think some sort of dedicated funding for social housing for the Grangemouth area, just to, you know, again, if that money becomes available, we can start putting some houses in place, and then we can start improving the community, and that would be one of those early wins. So, but in saying that, I feel like those sound maybe a bit sort of low in terms of aspirations, but I think those sorts of things to me would feel like we're getting something really significant out of it.
Adam, do you think there's anything more the Scottish Government or UK Government should be doing?
Yes. I'll put it jointly, because I hold council, government, Scottish and national all as one. Yous all represent communities that possibly live adjacent to wind farms. And it's just to touch on what Malcolm says, other areas, Falkirk may look at Grangemouth and think, why Grangemouth? Why is Grangemouth getting that? Every community that hosts these wind farms, which size-wise is nothing compared to Grangemouth, they all receive community funds. I believe there should be a community fund for Grangemouth. Without directly asking for it, our plan of a parking levy creates that. And what that fund would be, that we would look to have that fund actually managed by the community, so it empowers the community. So when there's issues in our community, as in we have a problem at the moment with separating HGVs with non-industrial traffic, there's an argument at the moment between Falkirk Council and the Scottish Government, who's paying facilities for HGV drivers. At the moment, we're paying for them because we're having to host them. The problem isn't being solved. We're seeing an argument in the middle. So, one, I would like to see a community fund for Grangemouth, solely for Grangemouth. And I would like to see better partnership between the Scottish and Falkirk Council, where we actually solve problems, not create problems that the public are then having to host in Grangemouth, and that is through funding.
Okay, and lastly, Dermot.
Thank you. So I think a lot is already happening. So there's a lot of good work, a lot of powerful work. But I suppose, to your point, Colin, around what more could be done. So I think there's something around on the joint government bits, on UK and Scottish government bit, around the just transition for community. There's an accountability piece. So how we mobilise the totality of senior level leadership. And the way that we structure business case and finance, as Malcolm said, around this strategically important geography to UK and Scotland. So accountability. Second one is conditionality. Be really interesting to look at as we're moving across the landscape and the plethora of different funds, small funds, big funds, you know, and Adam and colleagues will be trying to get money and kind of bring it down. And it has all sorts of different kind of conditions. But this area is so strategically important to the just transition of Scotland, to the lives of the community. How can we organise some of those funds so that they are all gearing and moving in the same direction? Thirdly, around coordination. I know that Malcolm's laid out the commitment to the master plan, but that commitment to the master plan and the responsibility that he's taken on it needs other agencies to kind of come round it, government agencies, non-government agencies, so the help and support at UK Scottish government level to bring around it. Let's pile it in and help. And then I suppose finally it's the capacity. I think Adam rightly has highlighted that it's the most consulted community in Scotland. You've got 10 people regularly doing more than the shift for the community. So how do we invest more capacity at the community level? So how can agencies invest? Partly that's about taking responsibility of not asking questions of the community that have been asked a million times before. Partly that is agencies trying to say, listen, why don't we join up on two or three things? And partly it's about looking at how do we make the best use of the third sector resources that are out there, the community resources that are out there and others. But if government as a whole, so on the kind of coordination kind of bit, was looking more around the accountability to just transition, conditionality of joining up the funds, coordination of the various different initiatives to help, not to do, and then also to kind of keep asking the question of how can we support the capacity, then it would feel that it's not Adam only trying to solve this, it's not Walter only trying to solve this, that there's a Team Scotland approach to it, a Team UK approach to it, which helps the industrial transition. It helps Malcolm with some of the difficult complexities of moving through stuff. But probably more importantly, it helps the young people in Grangemouth High School or the young people in Carron Grange High School and the communities to know that there are things behind them. So I would say those four things: accountability, conditionality, coordination and capacity.
Thank you. Thank you. Maggie Chapman, followed by Fiona Heslop.
Thanks very much, Claire, and good morning to you all. Thank you for joining us this morning and for what you've said so far today. It's been really, really interesting. I want to just tease out a couple of things that have come up already and maybe take them off in slightly different directions. I'm struck by the tension or disconnect that we've heard between the different visions, different definitions that we have at industry, community, the different parts of Grangemouth that we're talking about. Malcolm, from the perspective of the growth deal or GFIB, the professionalised structures or institutions of just transition strategy and delivery, if you like, is there maybe too much focus on the process of transition being just rather than what we're talking about, which is a transition to justice? And does that actually, thinking of it in a different way, does that actually allow us to talk about some of the things that Adam has already raised, the gaps, the failures, the negative impacts that the community has felt?
I guess if I start with the Falkirk growth deal, I think that's it's the Falkirk growth deal. It's not just for Grangemouth, and
yeah,
I don't. And the nature of the growth deal is: can you put forward compelling business cases that allow an increased GVA in your area? Mm-hmm. And the nature of that then spills into the fact that typically what you're going to be doing is trying to think, how can we create employment or investment? Mm-hmm. And those things maybe aren't directly addressing some of the concerns that Adam's raising this morning. So it's not that growth deal investment is wrong. It's almost it's the growth deal investment will facilitate, you know, improve skills training through Forth Valley College that allow young people in the Falkirk area and Grangemouth to capitalise on this transition to hydrogen, etc. And then they'll have brighter futures. If we bring incubator hubs for those technologies as well, then we can, you know, protect Falkirk's position as a kind of leading player in the Scottish and UK area for these sort of green energy approaches. The bit of the growth deal that really addresses or should address what Adam's raised and what Dermot's talked about is the £10 million for Greener Grangemouth. Now, I'm absolutely delighted that there's £10 million dedicated to Greener Grangemouth, but I've said to Dermot before, and I don't, you know, £10 million doesn't get you a lot these days, you know, so we can't go around saying Greener Grangemouth's going to fix anything because, you know, I can barely build a road for £10 million. So there's got to be some sort of expectation management in terms of that. And but that's not to say, therefore, our aspirations are sort of diminished in terms of what we need to do. But I feel like that's the narrative around the growth deal. And I think was the other one, GFIB.
I mean, I mentioned GFIB, but it's more that I suppose that broader picture. I mean, we've focused so much on you know, incubator hubs, on the different elements of the industrial transition, and I think we sometimes lose the actual vision here, which is what we're talking about: a transition to justice for everybody, whether you work in the energy sector, whether you work in, you know, a corner shop on the high street. It should be for everybody. And I think the institutions of just transition, I think, miss that sometimes. And the economic metrics you talk about are really important. We need those. We need to track those. But it's the outcomes. It's for the young people, you know, being able to do their hires where they live rather than being taxied somewhere else. And we don't focus. I don't think we get to there in our planning.
I agree. And I think there's an element here that the funding available to local authorities typically comes with those strings attached. Mm-hmm. And there isn't so much funding available for generic placemaking, you know, that, yeah. You know, because effectively it feels like what we're saying here today is, do you know what, we need a lot of money to invest in social housing to create a better neighbourhood, and we need some improved investment in like an HGV truck park so that they can wait there before doing their deliveries, and we need to kind of improve the town centre environment so that people feel proud of the area that they live in and get a sense of satisfaction from that. And the money from that typically probably needs to sit with the council, but as we're all familiar with, the council budgets are very stretched at the moment, which means our ability to borrow off our own revenue budgets a challenge. But I don't want to make that as an argument until I've got my list that says, here's the five things we would definitely do, here's the cost that they would make, that the community have said, we love those, that's how we, see, if you do that, that'll make our lives loads better. And that then I've gone round with a begging bowl and said, how do we make this happen? Mm-hmm. And until such time as people have said, no, you can't have it, then, you know, for me, the responsibility sits with me to, because I'm not in that place. I haven't, you know, I never want to sort of say it's someone else's fault until we've created that mm-hmm. vision, make sure we've got the plan in place, and then said, how do we afford it and all the things? Because although I've set a rather bleak vision of public sector funding, if you come up with shovel-ready projects, money does sometimes just emerge that you can then get an opportunity from. It's about making sure that you've got that drawer full of the five things that we need to do and they're all ready to go. We just need the money. But I don't have those five things, and until I do, okay. I can't sit here.
Just one thing, and maybe this relates to some of that question around vision, but earlier in your answer to the first question about the definition of just transition, you said, you know, there needs to be a good discussion with that community engagement, and then it's your job to articulate that definition, what it means back to the community. It struck me that that's kind of the wrong way round, because if it's genuine engagement, the community knows what it means. You don't need to articulate it back to them. And I'm just wondering whether there's actually, we're not doing co-production of either the definition of just transition or the vision for Grangemouth, and whether we need to rethink some of the focus of, again, how we do, you know, it's not that doing to communities, it's actually facilitating communities to create their own vision that you then go and implement.
I totally accept the point you're making. I think where I feel like just transition is an academical kind of vision of what we're talking about here, and that isn't words that I think the community would typically engage with, and I think we've heard in shorthand effectively. There's lots of things happening at that complex that affect us as a community. We don't appear to be getting anything out of it. Yeah. What are we getting out of it? Because it's not fair that we have to put up with those things. And so I think that's what I meant in terms of the just transition. If we go around talking about just transition, I don't think that's going to resonate that well with. Yeah. But if we work on that principle that we know that means that happens, therefore there needs to be some sort of benefit. I think that was more the point. Yeah. But I totally hear what you say. I think the only other thing I would say is that I'm so aware that the amount of engagement that's been done with the community, and I think you can hear some of that sort of and I don't so I don't want to do much more engaging. I want to more come back with here's what we're going to do to help. Does that look right? And that's the level of engagement. But I don't know if Dermot, there was a workshop that we did with the public last week, which the sense that I got was that it was a well-received and a sort of positive step forward. And I don't mean, therefore, everything's fixed. I just mean that engagement is still a positive engagement.
Yeah, and Adam was there. It was a positive engagement, and as you would expect, from Grangemouth, it articulated the good stuff and the challenges. I suppose for me, there's an interesting flow around your question, Maggie. And for me, the flow is around outcomes, cash, tools and plan. So what we have is a whole pile of information. The NHS has gathered tons of information. We've got lots from the Community Action Plan. Behind the Community Action Plan, there's a load of evidence around performance on certain indicators at the moment. So we've got a lot of things. So one of the bits that we've tried to do in the Greener Grangemouth is just to try and understand that stuff a bit. And so, yes, we only have 10 million, but we could choose not to understand the stuff and just kind of go, here's the thing for 10 million.
Yeah.
Good luck. So the first bit is just to try and understand the stuff. And we felt that was important so that if I'm in Grangemouth Library, as I was last week, I have half a clue of what's happened before, and I'm paying people the respect of having at least looked at what's been said before. Mm-hmm. So I think whether you're spending 10 million, 100 million or 1 billion, you probably should read what's been said before. And around that, some of the patterns of the outcomes that we need to target on are there. The opportunity for Greener Grangemouth is it's a small amount of cash, but the small amount of cash need to link to the outcomes of what's already been said. So that does navigate what we would and wouldn't spend it on. But it's a sort of unique position, because often what happens is you have to create a master plan to decide what to do, for which then you have to go hunting money. Mm-hmm. We're in the unusual position of having a small bag of cash before the master plan, which means if we drive it from an outcomes point of view and we direct that 10 million in a way that is purposeful and useful, and then we surround that 10 million with a bit of coordination and a pipeline of all of the rest, you have half a master plan with half a chance of getting done. So I think what's interesting on the flow is that if at the heart of the outcomes is justice, then the way that we spend the 10 million has to help justice, but not solve it. and that has to help, you know, attract and coordinate the rest of it, which then builds on it, which then starts to position a master plan that says, this is what we need to do, this is what it's going to cost, this is what who needs to do it and whatnot. You know, so you've got a much stronger confidence mm-hmm. in a plan rather than a plan with hope, if you like. So, and yeah. I think that to your point on and to be honest, it's been an interesting journey. Sometimes people have been frustrated with us saying, why can't you just kind of come up with the projects? And part of it is because there's been so much said about this area yeah. that we need to understand yeah. this before we start telling. Who am I to tell Adam, I think what you need is an X, having mm-hmm. never looked at it? So I think that flow of outcomes, cash, tools and plan is important for Greener Grangemouth, for the Grangemouth Future Industries Board, for the Greenport or whatever. There's a lot there already. We don't need to engage everybody over and over mm-hmm. on that. What we need to engage people is, what are we going to do and where are we going to get to? So I think that there is more engagement needed, but the focus of that engagement is different, you know, with confidence.
OK, thank you. Adam, if I can come to you. Colin Smith picked up a point about trust, and Dermot has just talked about, you know, respecting the people of Grangemouth by finding out what's already gone before. But there's... Do you think that you are here representing the Community Council and the wider community, do you think there's that trust has broken down between the institutions, the corporations that have whose operations have had the negative impacts you've described, public agencies that have maybe not listened and, you know, have watered down the plans, the things? If there's a breakdown of that trust, can and should the community trust corporations, public bodies to actually get this right? And what do you see as being fundamental to rebuilding and sustaining that trust for the next, you know, for the next period of time, whether that's months, years or decades?
That's a lot of questions in one.
Sorry, yeah, I'm good at that.
I'll answer this by the Community Action Plan. Investigate ways to improve relationship between local industry and the local community. This includes community members. Mm-hmm. This be done by 2030. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there is a breakdown. There is no two ways about it. Do we need to solve that? Absolutely. I've been really pessimistic here about Grangemouth. I think Grangemouth's a wonderful place. I actually run a group, and I've sat long enough saying, we don't get this, we don't get this, we don't get this. When you look at, we made reference to Zelton Park Regeneration Project, mm-hmm. which was Partnership Council. I run Shire Park Project, which was completely community-based. Mm-hmm. You also have the G-Letter team, who are going around Grangemouth. We're having 1,000 trucks a day. And the reality is, not all of them, of course, not all of them, but there's a lot of antisocial problems come with that. Litter. We're picking up litter pickers. We're changing our town. Mm-hmm. I believe, whether it be Falkirk Council, Scottish Government or anything, if they're not going to change our town, we'll do it for ourselves for the benefit of our town, because we don't have to accept the way it is. I'm hoping that government and local gets on board with that, but at the same time, I believe we can do it for ourselves. But I do believe that both sides has a responsibility for, mm-hmm. which is probably a generational decline in our town. And that's no, that there's certainly no political side to that, because that goes across all political divides. We've spoke in depth a few times that we believe is the Grangemouth community is actually Scotland's hidden shame because of where we are, because of the importance to our economy and the community we live in. Mm-hmm. There's been, I wouldn't mind just while you're talking there, is just to jump back on a point that we spoke about. I think it was TIFF we spoke about, and we spoke about how we would be engaged in different communities, and it also cover about what we talk about, what you spoke about not having the funding to do things. It's more important that as a community, and I'll give an example of this, where TIFF opened up better flow and traffic from the motorways into Grangemouth. That traffic then flows into Grangemouth, and this is something that, from a personal experience, as the roads are so congested, it's unsafe for you to walk your family to school. And then you go to the council, can we do something about this? No, we can't. We can't afford that. We don't have the funding, which they don't. And we see that in all walks, whether it be building new housing, you need the infrastructure for that. It's important that the infrastructure of Grangemouth isn't built to the detriment. And that can be wee things. It doesn't need to be the big things. And I think it's just a point that I was wanting to, been nipping at me there, and I wanted to pull into that. Does that answer your question? Or
that's helpful. And I think there's that something else that we need to think of, the potential negative consequences of good intentions somewhere else, and we don't always make those connections. Final question, Adam, what would you need from us to support and facilitate the capacity that we've heard is, you know, we've heard that, you know, there's been a lot of engagement, there's obviously a lot of will to engage and to contribute, and as you say, make Grangemouth for you.
Yeah.
What is it that would just make that little bit easier for you, the others on the community council, and others in the community to be part of all of the discussions we've been talking about having?
We've talked about short, medium and long-term plans.
Mm-hmm.
Trust is an issue, and we've talked about small gains. And I will jump in there, because that meeting we had last week, the £10 million isn't ideal. Ideally, we would have an open chequebook and we'd do whatever we want to do in Grangemouth. As a community council, we're envisaging that as almost seed funding, where we can access other funding elsewhere. And that's not just going to be your task, because, as I say, that's what we're planning. I'm a wee bit lost here. Sorry, go and see your question again.
So what is it to... What would help build the capacity of the community to continue with this, with these discussions, with the engagement, with the vision processes, with actually just being and creating the Grangemouth, the just Grangemouth you want?
We need an absolute vision of how this works for everybody. I mean, we've heard... I've seen things that the council have came from, and we're obviously at an early stage. This plan of a train station, we already, for those of you that aren't aware of Grangemouth, we already have rail in Grangemouth. We used to have a rail station. Something like that, even beginning a stag report, you'll no see a train station delivered for 5 years. But it would say to the community it's coming.
It matters.
Yeah, in short term, the community need to buy into it. And every one of these meetings, and we go away and it's 2 years later and nothing happens, it just underlines what the community is already feeling. We need a short-term fix. And I think if we had a commitment to a stag report, that would make a big difference. And it would get more of the non-industrial side of the community on board. That's what I think we need. Mm-hmm. From a Scottish Government point of view, there's a lot of promises made. I noted some of them down about Freeport, Greenport, however you want to put it. We need the government, the industrial and industry says one thing. We need feet to the fire for the promises that are made. And whether that's a constitution of trust for Grangemouth, so that when, for example, I can't remember the last time there was a job fair in Grangemouth.
Right.
So where is the commitment? I mean, from Malcolm's point of view, he'll look at it as a Falkirk White thing. Whereas it's jobs for the whole of Falkirk, whereas I'm more local. And I've got to look at local first, and it's got to be local people first. I would like to, for argument's sake, if we're talking about constitution of trust, how's a bit of promise for anybody that applies from AFK3 areas promised an interview? Mm-hmm. Something like that. A commitment from employers where they'll at least look at the local employment and give consideration to them. Just wee things like that makes a big difference. In my own opinion, it's just...
Thank you. Those are really interesting ideas. I could go on, but
okay. The witnesses have very generously given, I think, more time than was anticipated this morning. But I've maybe got a couple of members left to ask questions, so I'll hand over to Fiona Hislop.
Thank you. And we do think Grangemouth is special and important, which is probably the first time a parliamentary committee has done such a focus on one particular town. And although the just transition will impact on everybody in Scotland, everybody automatically thinks about the North East, but we've decided first to look at Grangemouth because if we can learn lessons here, we can help the rest of Scotland. And I was very struck, Adam, that your perspective, you were talking about that, those 20,000 additional jobs that we've been told will come with the Freeport, and that you want them to not drive in, drive out, that you might want them to stay, and if they are going to travel in, you want them to have the rail links to public sector, which in and of itself is about town centre regeneration. This committee has just done an inquiry into town centre regeneration, and one of the issues was about making sure that local, it's community-led. Now, you've said what you want, but also that there's revenue that provides kind of resource, as in people, to help you do what you do. So have you got access to any, whether it's community development workers or people that the community council can say, this is what we want done, or can you look at these reports that you're getting from left, right and centre? Is there anything like that just now?
We do have support from Falkirk Council, whether it's sports hubs or the social side of education. We obviously have food banks and things like that, and we're offered support through development for ourselves and different things that we do day to day to improve as a community council.
Because I'm also very struck that Damon's talking about spend this 10 million quickly, and it's capital and it's 2 million revenue, but it'd be interesting to know what's happening with the revenue, because we also know from our last inquiry that you know capital might be easier to come by, but revenue to sustain, you know, the people that can help staff, this isn't there. I don't know if there's a, and maybe Michelle can help me, or you can help me, is there a Grangemouth Improvement District, Business Improvement District, a bid or anything around that area? Because I'm very conscious now, I represent Linlithgow constituency next door, and it's brought together community interests, the Community Development Trust, and also business. And there's obviously a levy around that that helps them employ staff to do this kind of work. And I don't know whether that was Dame, or you were thinking about looking at Hoyk or different other areas on the borderlands. It's actually about how do you build in people support, so for the decision makers, which should be the community. Is that the sort of thing you were thinking about?
Absolutely, yeah, 100%. So that there's no point in building something that we don't think, you know. So if SFT has taken some responsibility around the town centre work, as you've laid out, then it's our job to work with Adam to say, we think here are some things that are definitely going to work, that will work for the future. And underpinning that then is the investment in the people infrastructure, the kind of support skills, some of the organisational capacity skills, some of the sustainability and kind of business bits. So that's where the revenue funding is really quite important. It's to work with Adam and colleagues to say, what is the best way of using that? And also, what is the cash flow of that across the 10-year time period? So it could be that it moves in different ways to kind of get a surge quickly and then, you know, scale it down as the organisations start to feel more responsible and capable. So absolutely. And I suppose to pick up on Adam's point, there are already, you know, supports, the community planning and the community team are fantastic. They're in Grangemouth. We're doing lots of really great work. But if Greenport are offering in little bits and pieces with revenue and Grangemouth Future Industry is offering bits and pieces in revenue, then I suppose our thinking is, why don't we just create a pot and just pile it into the pot and get the pot to get behind Adam and Walter and other folk. So that's part of the Greener Grangemouth work, is then saying, what would it be for then?
Does so that we can pile it Adam, in. Adam, is that what you're looking for?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I'm very struck, Adam, you're the person that's talking about the strategic aspects of this.
Yeah.
And also you're the person that's talked about the kind of non-industrial future industries side. It's the existing businesses that can grow with those income coming hopefully from those 20,000 additional workers. So how do we mobilise the non-industrial site aspects of Grangemouth to be connected? Because when we talk about community, it's not just community as individuals.
Yeah.
It's actually the local businesses. So what's your view on how that can best be done?
When you government discusses economic development, they never discuss the retail side of it.
Yeah.
Mm. If there's two sets, as I say, what we would like to see is the introduction of a parking levy, which would have a huge impact on what we could do as a community. It would make our everything sustainable. What we didn't want to see is a spend and run.
Yeah.
And it looks all right there. And then we go, we need it to be sustainable. Two sides of that is you couldn't implement something like that if you don't have proper public transport, which we don't at the moment. We have buses and that's it. And most of what we have actually comes from outside the district. Mm-hmm. So we would need more than just buses. What that would see is the people that didn't want to be filtered through the town to go round the industry would then be paying a parking levy charge at work, if you like, or the business would be paying it, however you wanted to structure it. And so the people that come into the town would be spending the town, which is then seen a regeneration of the town, economically, if you like, the retail sector of it. And then from the other side of it, you could actually, from a community point of view, you could actually fund a free bus service around the town, which would benefit everybody when they come. So the wealth of the town would actually flow around it, creating jobs, and the economic development would be spread across all areas of our town.
And I take it in the housing, one of the issues about the plant itself is some of these workers could actually go anywhere internationally and get paid. So you actually want them to live in Grangemouth and spend in Grangemouth. So therefore, it's not just social housing. It's going to be any type of housing that attracts people to stay and spend in the town. And you see that as part of what this just transition should be, to keep the skill base that we know will be needed for that transition.
100%. All our housing is built in the 1970s.
Mm-hmm.
And it's seen as a place where if I want somewhere to live, I need somewhere to live, I'll apply for Grangemouth, I'll get a flat. That'll do me till I go somewhere else. You can't build a sustainable community on that. I mean, I think it's 30-odd% of you of the council's flatted stocks in Grangemouth. It's certainly a high percentage compared to what we are within the district.
Uh-huh.
As I say, there needs to be an appetite to change that.
Mm-hmm.
We have seen in the past where do we put the people in flats? And then there's new houses built. Well, why can't you take people to flats, put them in new build, take that down, build new houses again, and then start the rotation? Well, we can't do that because we need them there now. There's always a reason not to do it. You know, there needs to be an appetite. It's like I say, in all levels, it's let's deliver for Grangemouth. Let's change what it is. But we don't just need us three sitting saying this. We need every level saying that.
And finally, Malcolm, obviously Falkirk Council isn't just, it's not just Falkirk, it's obviously covers Grangemouth, and nobody's mentioned Bowness, so we better mention Bowness. But the Falkirk Growth Deals is a wider area, and the Greenports is a wider area. And the Falkirk, and the Grangemouth Future Industries Board kind of speaks for itself. It's about future industries, not that wider area. But your point about being the director of place, the other committee I sit on, the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, has just produced a report into local government partners. And one of the strong recommendations is place-based matters. That's how you can pull them together. So we're behind that agenda, but it's not for Falkirk Town, it's for Grangemouth. And how do you prioritise Grangemouth and do it strategically? Because housing and strategic housing provision is obviously key to this, with the big picture stuff of potentially district heating, possibly using hydrogen, who knows? But is that the kind of place you want to get to in looking at that place-based solution for Grangemouth itself?
I think for the place-based solution for Grangemouth, it's about creating a really sustainable 20-minute neighbourhood type that's a nice place to live, that people feel happy about it, that they can get the transport links that they want. So that, I guess that's what I'm trying to create. In terms of Grangemouth, I think that this discussion and coming to this committee has really sort of made it clear to me how we need to maybe enhance the narrative that Grangemouth does get a burden from having the fact that the industrial complex is so close to it, and therefore there needs to be a quid pro quo. And I don't think that if I went to parts of Falkirk, they would see that sense. You know, the narrative's more like, oh, they get the Kelpies, they get the, you know, all the jobs, they get, you know, and I'm not meaning that you do at all. I just more mean every community has its own little view. But I think collectively we need to maybe make a much stronger impact. Yeah, but they have this, you know, there's some really poor outcomes that we need to fix, and burdens on them caused by that industrial complex. And that's why we need this greater focus on Grangemouth and greater solutions. I wonder if, you know, we talk about business, and I haven't said before, but thinking here, a lot of the rates that are collected from Grangemouth go to the Scottish Government, and maybe there is some sort of discussion that needs to be had about some sort of reallocation of those rates on a very small scale, because even in a tiny scale, there could be some sort of benefit for the Grangemouth area. And that's the problem that we have as a council, that we can't easily grab some of the benefits that the industry creates to then reportion back to the Grangemouth area. Mm. So I think that, you know, if we're talking, you know, and I'm writing down here the Stag report and things like that, maybe that's a space we need to get into, in terms of there's no way as a council we're going to be able to fund a train station or be able to create Network Rail and ScotRail to, you know, support that. That's going to be a massive national discussion. But if we have a stronger narrative that there is a just transition required for the communities of Grangemouth, then I think maybe we'll have a better chance of getting there.
And we've heard about Greener Grangemouth. I think you've just come up with a new one, Greater Solutions Grangemouth, which sounds a bit more big and strategic as well. And just finally, one of the things that we've got concerns about is obviously the growth deals. Some of them have been in place for some time. Yours is more recent. But it might not be reflective of that net zero drive as was originally thought of, you know, in terms of when they were first established. So we're not unpicking growth deals because they were very carefully put together, but you talked about the need for flexibility, and it would be very helpful either just now if you could explain what that might look like, particularly if we're looking at just transition and net zero. And if you can't do that just now, maybe come back to us on that, because I think that would be quite helpful. And I don't know if Diarmaid has any comments on that would be.
Yeah, happy to pick up some of that. So the growth deal that we have for Falkirk includes a investment in the £10 million for Greener Grangemouth that we've talked at length, but there's also £30 million towards innovation projects linked to new technologies, such as, so there's a project for carbon utilisation, there's a project for biofuel, and there's a project for preparation of, it's called strategic sites, the preparation of land for, you know, inward investment to come in. And in addition, there's a major investment in a skills transition centre housed at Forth Valley College, to offer incubator and accelerator facilities, create a green curriculum and training opportunities to make sure that there's a workforce of young people ready to take advantage of these jobs that are created. So I think those speak to a kind of, you know, net zero kind of aspiration. In terms of the flexibilities that I sort of talk to, it's that some of these ideas come from discussions that were had in 2015, and then they led to a kind of submission, and then led to a kind of heads of terms award of money, and now we're trying to sort of work down into the detail. And in doing that, you've got 10 projects, and sometimes you might say, do you know what, because of construction inflation, because of changing circumstances in the economy, some of those don't actually look like they're going to make it. And that's okay, because not everything has to always be how it was conceived 4 or 5 years ago. And the flexibilities would be around having a kind of pragmatic conversation that says, could we maybe accept that those two don't look like they're going to make it in the way that we thought they would, but could we reallocate the money quickly to these other projects that have either emerged, or the existing projects that you think will make a difference but now need a bit of extra funding because of inflation. And I wouldn't want to portray it that the UK and Scottish governments are resistant to that sort of change. I think that that sort of discussion is happening across Scotland, but I think where I feel like is it's about pace. It's about, you know, almost, can we have a quick conversation about it? Can we present some information? Can we move at pace to a new zone without it taking maybe a long time to talk about that sort of flexibility? And I totally get that as UK and Scottish governments, you're giving us money and you want to make sure that we're spending it wisely and aren't just changing. But I think also it's that flexibility and sort of pragmatic approach that I'm sort of talking about.
Yeah. So we're the Parliament, so we can actually then make these points to the government. Yep. So maybe that might be helpful as well in terms of that's what we're trying to do with this inquiry, say what would be the most helpful things. So that's why recommendations to help inform the Just Transition Grangemouth plan from the government. So this is your opportunity to get that pitch. Have we got time to hear from Dermot on this? If you've got anything you want to say?
If it's brief.
Sure. So just building on flexibility, I guess one of the key issues in all of the growth deals is that there's quite a lot of investment in innovation. And innovation is not a linear process. You know, so as Malcolm laid out, the deal was constructed a number of years ago. Now we've moved into a different space. So the partners in the innovation and the methods of innovation and the shape of the innovation might change, will change. And so there might be risks. And so I think it's flexibility around how the outcome is achieved, but more particularly how the outcome is communicated. Mm-hmm. So because it seems to have moved or changed from what was said, doesn't mean the outcome's not going to happen. Yeah. So the second bit, I think, is just the advantage of the deal space to pick up your point around housing, Ms. Hislop, is that it gives you a 10-year horizon. And actually, the skeleton of an outstanding 20-minute neighbourhood is in Grangemouth. You can see how the active travel could connect on. You could see how the green space could connect on. You could see how that opens up if some of the industrial spaces around the eastern edge of the town were to shift and you had brownfield. You could see a supply of different land, a supply of different amenities, and moving it on. So I think it's important to be able to build on the foundations that are there, but also to try and coordinate a number of the different housing investments around that, so you can see it actually happening. And I suppose the final bit on that, again, is around how this town is communicated. Mm-hmm. So I've picked up on the outcome on the flexibility on the innovation, but I think it's really important the way that Grangemouth is communicated as an idea is not just the industrial complex. And it's certainly not just the deprivation that has happened, but it must pick up on some of the positivity and the energy from Adam and colleagues, and must pick up on the future story of where we're getting to. So I think there's a kind of an ask that we're all kept accountable not to communicate Grangemouth as the nexus of problems, but actually to start communicating its potential and to drive that.
Well, feel free to use Greater Solutions, Grangemouth.
Will do.
I'll pass you back to the convener.
Thank you, Mrs.
Thank you. It's interesting where the conversation ended up, because during the witness sessions, you know, I was reflecting on, we were talking about a just transition for Grangemouth. A just transition suggests you're going from somewhere already positive and viable to you're having to make a shift. And here it's the industrial complex having to make a shift to net zero. But the evidence we've heard from Adam and the paper from Adam, and I think Malcolm talked to as well about, you know, the high levels of low health, of unemployment, there's already, in some ways, lots of Grangemouth is still living by the industrial heritage from longer ago and is still living with the consequences of that. So when the government are putting together the draft plan that we're expecting towards the end of spring, and Malcolm, you kind of headed in this direction when you said we need to think not just about the industrial base here, it is about the broader community. And in some ways, they're starting at a completely different place from the industrial basis. The challenges they're facing is different. Would that be, you know, do you think government has... It's back to the question of what's the interpretation of just transitions. Do you anticipate the draft report, I think they're calling it a report, the plan from the government, will take a broader view? Is that something the committee should be emphasising, do you think, with the minister?
I have to be honest, I don't have detailed insight into the plan that comes forward. I think the fact that £10 million has been allocated to Greener Grangemouth shows that the Scottish Government does have a keen understanding of being able to support that. But whether or not the scale of what we've talked at length today about this isn't going to be a £10 million fix. This is a pretty significant fix, and I don't know to what extent the report that comes forward will address those aspects, because also there is a fundamental need to ensure that Scotland's economy or these industrial complexes transition successfully, and I don't think we can lose sight of that. You know, that has a huge, significant strategic impact on Scotland's future as a country. So, but I would hope that through the discussions that we've had today, that some of that will resonate up into the report.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, and Adam, I'll come to you. With the last kind of question, thank you for taking part this morning. And we have the minister coming in a few weeks, so he's the Scottish Government's representative. What's the kind of key thing we need to tell him about Grangemouth's future and what needs to happen in Grangemouth?
Grangemouth's transition needs to be inclusive, and it's an opportunity to not only evolve industry but evolve the community. And I probably think the best statement to make is levelling up the non-industrial community of Grangemouth. Mm-hmm. I think that is a key message. We need to transition the industry, absolutely 100%, and we're behind that. We try to look at the benefits that can be funneled through to the other side of Grangemouth, to bring Grangemouth up to what it should be, and it should be an example to where someone in Scotland would want to work, live and be part of a 20-minute neighbourhood.
That's great. Thank you to all the witnesses this morning for the time you've given us. I'll now move into private session.